History reminds us all the stumbling blocks that we have had throughout our lives. However, we keep falling into the same mistakes. We remain psychologically controlled, dominated. And in order to break this cycle, an individual initiative is required. With a lot of discipline, each of us has to end selfishness and replacing it with the unity. In the same way that our ancestors coexisted collectively in a more spiritual way, we are descendants of Aztlan, a pure race. Only with much knowledge, let's not let our past die. We must rescue our culture from the clutches of materialism, of the egoism, and ignorance. While this together is the cradle where envy, betrays, and racism is born, and all the negative energies that have attacked our people for over 500 years. It is time to repair the damage to the race of the cosmos. Quinto Sol, Hijos de Maíz.
Hello, welcome viewers, to the first episode of the Outlaw News, the voice of the barrio, who's not afraid to tell it like it is. They say history is written by its winners, if by winners they mean snitches, and law enforcement friendly authors, or media sources, whose fame, careers, income, and freedom came about by the close relationship they maintain with alphabet agencies, as so happens to be the unfortunately sad truth. When it comes to the history of the Barrio Loco, the Barrio, and Chicano prison lore, the very same people the Barrio detest, ostracize, or accuse of false accusations, civil rights violations, and racial profiling, are the very same individuals who have spoon-fed and glorified the Cholo culture and prison to acquire fame, finances, and careers. The homie has been brainwashed to accept the extremely biased and tainted history of the Barrio Loco, which glorifies, nurtures, and reinforces the criminal mentality. And does one thing, guarantees an increasing and steady flow of Chicanos into prison. The outlaw will take the Barrio Loco and viewers down a rabbit hole never been ventured, into the world of conspiracies, to answer the questions many have wondered, and some fear to ask. Who really runs, and why do gangs exist? Have street and prison gangs been infiltrated and social engineered? The Chicano movement and prison lore. The secret history of brown and black unity in the hood and prison. The truth behind TV shows like History Channel's Gangland, Fox's Cops, MSNBC Law Cop, and more. The snitch culture, a new trend, or always been around since the beginning. American Me, and Blood In Blood Out movie conspiracy, the homie, and patriotism. Mainstream and social media influence on the gangster culture. We'll profile the life and suspicious deaths of urban street legends. Exposés, revealing secrets about some well-publicized gang informants, prison, and street legends. The untold secret history of medical experiments on prisoners, and topics such as Zoot Suit Riots, Sleepy Lagoon Trial, Chicano Baseball League, the origins of net banging, crackdown on cruising, and more stories related to Chicanos and the Barrio Loco. Using books and video inserts, newspaper articles, never-before-seen court, and declassified documents, the outlaw will help the Barrio Loco break free from the programming and mental chains that society's oppression has placed upon the homie, to build pride, respect, and identity as a Barrio Loco, and understand in his overall place as a Chicano in society today. Never before under an era of Trump's campaign of racism, fear of COVID-19, the rise of SNY gangs, mass incarceration, protests over police brutality, or peace treaties in prison and on streets, has Aztlan rumbled so loud for the Barrio Loco to wake up. So the Outlaw News has been resurrected from the ashes of the Barrio to inform homies and be a voice of truth for the Barrio. Not just society, but the homies and the Barrio have come to a crossroads in the fight against oppression. Just look around our neighborhoods. The homies can no longer act blind or ignorant to the political climate in our streets and in prison today, numbing our reality with drugs, alcohol, and dark shades called mad doggers. the Bartoloco must decide which side of the fence he's on. He must realize the boot of oppression that bears down on him is not because he's a gangster and thug, but because he represents a symbol of the modern Indio Chicano resistance and refusal to conform to his oppressor's will. So let's get started with our first book titled Danger and Trust, San Quentin, the Mexican Mafia, and the Chicano Movement, authored by Ted Davidson. Mr. Davidson was an anthropology major who was recruited by his university at the request of California Department of Corrections and San Quentin officials to study the culture of Chicano prisoners. During 1966 to 1968, Mr. Davidson entered San Quentin. He came to learn and understand the Chicano prison culture. Developing close relationships with Chicano convicts alleged to belong to the Mexican Mafia, both in prison and on the streets. In 1968, Mr. Davidson would be banned from San Quentin, and the FBI attempted to set him up for revealing secrets that California Department of Corrections and San Quentin kept hidden from the public. By all accounts, Mr. Davidson's research and 1974 book Chicano Prisoners, The Keys to San Quentin, are the earliest known accounts of Mexican Mafia and its origins. Reading small quotations and some entire chapters to reveal a secret history of the barrio and Chicano prison lore that contradicts and even exposes some famous snitches and gang experts as liars. Your faithful narrator will stop periodically to point out important bits of information and commentary. The book again is Danger and Trust, San Quentin, the Mexican Mafia, and the Chicano Movement, by Ted Davidson, from the chapter The Outlaw. So you can have a better understanding of the origins and history of The Outlaw. The Outlaw, the prisoner's own newspaper, was a result of the extreme frustrations prisoners faced when trying to counter San Quentin's and CDC's ability to control information from inside the prison. My earlier section on CDC secrecy is quite pertinent here. Illegal and truly underground, The Outlaw rose from the covert depths of the prisoner's own culture, beginning in June 1967 and, having accomplished its major objective, voluntarily ending publication after 14 months in August 1968. It reported things that were very important to the majority of prisoners, important to taxpayers and legislators, but threatening to the status quo of CDC and San Quentin. The serious articles in The Outlaw dealt with the real prisoner culture, not with the ideal one about which administrators spoon-fed information to the public, including state legislators. Throughout CDC, prison administrators had long been able to minimize and almost completely avoid the real issues behind work strikes and protests by prisoners. As I learned more about those real issues and the unsuccessful attempts of prisoners who attempted to publicize those issues, I too became frustrated and angry. For example, early in my research, ML, who had already become my extremely close Chicano convict friend, paused for a moment to point out the ML is an alleged member of the Mexican Mafia. His, as well as other alleged members' names, are kept secret to protect the men from the wrath of California Department of Corrections. Let's return back to the book Danger and Trust, San Quentin, the Mexican Mafia, and the Chicano Movement. Suggested I read original memos from 1963 that were written by administrators at Folsom Prison. Memos were hidden from public view in a San Quentin prisoner's record jacket. This prisoner had been one of the leaders of the October 1963 work strike by prisoners at Folsom Prison. The real strike issues involved policies and actions of the adult authority that prisoners felt were abusive. However, Folsom administrators had been able to avoid the major issues behind the strike. Publicly, as revealed in my newspaper review of the San Francisco Chronicle and Sacramento Bee for that period, prison administrators repeatedly indicated that the prisoners were striking for better food, more pay for their prison jobs, and shorter prison terms. The real issues were never mentioned. Temporarily jumping ahead to 1973, in order to further illustrate the ability of prison administrators to control what information is released to the public about events inside San Quentin, let me share my disappointment. In 1973, when prisoners at San Quentin did not have The Outlaw as their spokesman, prisoners went on strike. The prisoners had a list of 17 demands. Some still important demands included issues such as abolition of the adult authority, abolition of the indeterminate sentence system, and legal representation for prisoners at parole hearings. Those issues were virtually ignored in what was spoon-fed to the media by administrators. Instead, less important, but more colorful demands such as resignation of the warden and two associate wardens, conjugal visits and public phones inside were stressed. Also, administrators found that the easiest way to minimize the effect of protest against the prison or CDC was to discredit the prisoners who led protests by calling them militants or revolutionaries. This tactic also was used against outsiders who openly demonstrated in support of prisoners. The outsiders also were called militants or revolutionaries, thus discrediting them too. Now, returning to 1967 and 1968, let me share some more facts about the outlaw, because it was the driving force behind Convict Unity Holiday. Despite all staff attempts to suppress the outlaw, ML, one of the editors, and the other prisoners who published it were determined to try to accomplish something that had never before occurred. Pause here. We see that ML, an alleged Mexican mafia member, is editor for an underground prisoners newspaper, and involved with politically organizing fellow Chicano prisoners. For some odd reason, high-profile gang experts, ex-Mexican mafia turned informants, or to religion never discuss, or make vague mentions with little to no details of political consciousness among Chicano prison organizations. Like what has been done to Rudy Cadena's legacy. Maybe, the mainstream narrative feels it should take a backseat to polarizing the Chicano and culture as criminals. As you continue to follow this channel, the Bardo Loco will be exposed to the truth of Chicano political consciousness in prison, and the efforts to keep it hidden from the homies. Now let's continue reading Danger and Trust, San Quentin, the Mexican Mafia, and the Chicano Movement. At first, the outlaw was able to print hundreds of copies of each edition, using the prison mimeograph machines. Soon the staff put all such machines under lock and key, but that did not stop the efforts. Locks and keys were no deterrent. However, the price of mimeograph stencils, paper and ink skyrocketed again, no of to the determination of the publishers and their supporters. Even the mimeograph machines were so heavily controlled by staff they normally were beyond the use of prisoners, and when stencils doled out through sign-up sheets, the publishers prevailed. True, by this time tall stacks of the outlaw no longer appeared inside cell block. However, single sheet editions were distributed to convicts. Those single sheet editions were repeatedly passed from prisoner to prisoner. Also, a copy of each edition appeared on Warden Nelson's desk. Any prisoner who was caught by the guards with a copy of the outlaw in his possession was thrown in the hole for 29 days, no questions asked. Prisoners who were believed to be directly involved in its publication were transferred to other prisons and put in the hole there. A convict who was accused by the staff of being the editor spent nearly 2 years in the adjustment center at Folsom because of that allegation, which was not true. Even after 50 or more convicts had been transferred to other prisons, the outlaw continued. Personally, I was amused that the staff tried to defeat the outlaw. I had an idea that would have soon destroyed the effectiveness of the outlaw. However, I never shared my idea with the staff. I realized that, if the staff produced many outrageously fictitious editions of the outlaw and had their snitches distribute them to prisoners, the majority of prisoners would perhaps be amused at the ridiculous stories, but would soon realize that the outlaw, both legitimate and fictitious ones, was merely a joke and not to be trusted. Although ML and the other convicts who published the outlaw hoped that some editions would reach the streets and be brought the attention of the public, they were not sure if their efforts being noted on the streets. They realized that a way they might be able to draw more attention to their cause and exert more pressure on the prison administrators would be to successfully publicize some of the major problems facing the prisoners and try to bring even more attention to their concerns by a demonstration inside and the publicity that might ensue. So, a January 1968 issue of The Outlaw set forth the details about Convict Unity Holiday. Quote from my copy of that edition. Note, each edition had the same large, hand-lettered banner. The Outlaw, by Beek San Quentin. January 1968. On February 15, 1968, those areas which will be exempt from the movement will be as follows: These areas are essential and should continue to operate. 1. Hospital, 2. Mess hall, 3. Boiler room, 4. Block workers, let us take the opportunity to assure each and every one of you that we can be successful if, and only if, we remain united. The efforts of each man will be vital to the ultimate outcome. On February 15, 1968, the eyes of many people will focus upon you, convicts and free people alike, anxiously awaiting to see if we have the ability and courage to stand up for something worthwhile. Let's not disappoint them. Above all, let us not disappoint ourselves. Unity, that's what we need. We must not resort to any type of violence. Otherwise, we will destroy what we have worked so hard to gain. We, of the Outlaw, have taken many chances in keeping you posted on the evils which exist within the administration. Now, we offer you a few of the things we expect to gain, if we stand together. Remember, on February 15, 1968, on call for lockup, go to your cell. Do not become involved in anything. This is important. The first sign of a disturbance, this administration will fire tear gas and bullets. Some will be injured, as we panic in an attempt to scatter. We must not permit this. If no lockup is called on this day, the same movement will remain in effect for the following day, and will remain in effect until the administration calls a lockup. Do not report to work. Here are a few changes we expect to be brought out. An opportunity for all parole violators to be afforded a hearing in the court of law, to call witnesses in their behalf, to cross-examine those witnesses who appear against them, to be represented by counsel. 2. Complete abolishment of the increased penalties for narcotics offenders with prior felony convictions. Several men here are now serving anywhere from 10 to 15 years to life as a result of this stupid law. Isn't 5 years to life sufficient? The penalty is no deterrent to crime. This has been proven time and again. 3. That more favorable consideration be given to first offenders when their minimum time is completed. To compel a person to linger in prison can only lead to forming a hardened criminal. Too much time destroys any constructive things the prisoner has accomplished. 4. A demand for the removal of all ex-law enforcement officers from the adult authority, and that they be replaced with professors, psychologists, etc., who are more familiar with the criminal. 5. The immediate removal of all child sex offenders to mental hospitals, where they can receive the help necessary to overcome their illness. 6. To compel the adult authority to reconsider all cases who appeared before them since October 1967 AT, the time which the new time scale went into effect. Almost all prisoners WHO appeared before the board since October have been denied. A good indication that you will do more time. 7. Demands for better food and living conditions within the prison. Approximately $2,600 is appropriated annually for your support. Did you know that $14 is appropriated each year just so you can have a new mattress? How long has it been since you've had one? This is just one item. We couldn't begin to list them all. 8. Complete revision of the present pay scale. Prices in the canteen continue to shoot skyward. The draw has been raised to $30 a month. Can't you draw $30 on your present pay? 9. Demand that a doctor be available within the prison around the clock in order to prevent unlawful deaths such as that of Walter Atkinson, on November 5, 1964. Didn't think we knew about that, did you, Dr. McNamara? Want us to give you a full report? He died as a result of respiratory difficulty, this is true. But only because his jaws were wired together following surgery, and he strangled on his own vomit. You were drunk when you finally did show up, weren't you, doctor? We know. We also have photostat copies of the complete records. Wonder if John Conley, DDS, would support your claims. We will see soon enough. 10. That your parole officer be compelled to put the approval of any request you make in writing in order that he may not be permitted to use these things to justify violating the conditions of your parole at his own whim or caprice. These are the more important things we expect to accomplish as a result of our movement. There are other issues, some more important, others less, which we will bring to you as soon as the complete format has been drawn, Let me back up slightly at this point. During the summer of 1967, ML shared a copy of The Outlaw with me and explained what they ultimately hoped to accomplish. In addition to major articles dealing with serious issues, the writers always included some trivial things seen as lighthearted to prisoners but embarrassing to staff, things such as a supposedly secret affair a certain guard was having with another guard's wife. The trivia was included to keep the general prisoner readership interested in reading The Outlaw and looking forward to the next edition. However, the staff was furious about both the serious and lighthearted subjects. Gradually, I accumulated quite a collection of outlaws which ML surreptitiously gave to me when I was in the prison. I became extremely upset with the serious issues raised by The Outlaw. I knew that the convicts who produced the paper wanted some of the editions to reach the streets and be brought to the attention of the public. After a few months, the public release of The Outlaw yet to occur, and the possibility of it happening did not appear to be promising. Consequently, I asked ML if he would be agreeable to my anonymously and surreptitiously sharing some copies of The Outlaw and discussing the prisoner's concerns with the outside press. He was delighted, but concerned that someone might snitch on me, resulting in my being kicked out of San Quentin. I was willing to take the risk in order to get the public's attention and hopefully have the information reach legislators. The major San Francisco Bay Area newspapers were reluctant to report about the forthcoming convict unity holiday. Stop, okay, we have mainstream media outlets reluctant to cover a prison story about peace and unity between prisoners at San Quentin, with the source being inmates themselves. If this was a story of rioting or murder within the walls of San Quentin or any other prison, it would have made headlines on every major media outlet, using only the official press release from the prison as its source of information. In fact, most of the time media outlets reprint or repeat word for word the official press release without fact-checking, speaking with prisoners or family about incidents in prison. Back to the book Danger and Trust, San Quentin, the Mexican Mafia, and the Chicano Movement by Ted Davidson. However, the Berkeley Barb, the popular underground San Francisco Bay Area newspaper widely distributed and sold on Bay Area streets, was not. At the beginning of January, I approached Jim Schreiber, one of the Barb's best reporters. He agreed to not reveal me as the source of the information which I shared with him during a several-hour-long interview. I also gave Jim copies I had made of about 40 pages of The Outlaw, including the January 1968 issue quoted above. Within a few days, the next weekly edition of the Barb had the entire front page and both middle pages devoted to convict unity holiday and The Outlaw. For weeks, until well after the prisoner's holiday, the Barb's coverage, with pictures and revealing articles, continued. ML was delighted with the Barb's coverage. He was amused that the Barb was regarded as an underground newspaper, noting that its address and phone number appear in each edition. He added that The Outlaw truly is underground. News from the Barb immediately generated reaction by younger adults and other people on the streets, those who routinely read the Barb and often were involved in social action. A major demonstration of support for the prisoners by various groups and people was planned for February 15th, outside the main gate of San Quentin. It was a demonstration that had quickly taken on a life of its own. I approached Daryl Lemke, the San Francisco reporter for the Los Angeles Times, who did agree to talk with me. In his San Francisco office, I added details to what had been reported in the Barb and gave him a couple of copies of The Outlaw. He thanked me and assured my confidentiality would be respected. However, somewhat to my disappointment, he said he would not immediately report on what I had shared with him in order to not create news. However, he assured me that if convict unity holiday did occur, he would write an article about it. Later, after the prisoner's holiday began, he used my material and wrote what I consider was, by far, the best article by the non-underground press. It appeared in both the Los Angeles Times and the San Francisco Chronicle. Administrators tried to keep prisoners from knowing what might occur on the 15th. The Barb was forbidden inside, but that didn't stop some staff from bringing copies in. As with The Outlaw, if a prisoner was caught with a copy of the Berkeley Barb, he would be thrown into the hole for 29 days, no questions asked. prisoners actually were uncertain if a demonstration would occur outside to support them. Even those of us on the outside were not certain if or how large the demonstration would be. Consequently, from past experiences, many prisoners were reluctant to expect very much. For me, February 14th, the day before a convict unity holiday, proved to be tremendously interesting and packed with excitement, fear and surprise, which combined to make the day truly unforgettable. The prisoners were cautious, tempering their excitement so they would not be too disappointed if the demonstration fizzled the next day. During the morning, I visited an Anglo prisoner who was the clerk in the hospital pharmacy. He had an interesting prison job working in the pharmacy. The staff had always been careful to try to have the prisoner in that job be a trustworthy one who would not deal drugs to prisoners. The convicts always had been able to manipulate the prisoner who held that job. Even though this pharmacy clerk was not Chicano, I had been assured that he was trustworthy convict-like. We talked for a few minutes, and before I left he whispered that he had a copy of the latest edition of The Outlaw which he would give to me. Very interested in what the latest issue would have to say, I took the single-page issue, folded it a couple of times, and slipped it under my belt, inside my pants. Soon I was leaving through the count gate to go to lunch in the staff snack bar. As soon as I was outside the gate, a custody lieutenant came up and started walking beside me. He said, "The warden wants to see you." I did a double take, but immediately thought that someone must have said that I intended to tell it like it is. So, since I had repeatedly practiced how I would explain that comment to satisfy staff curiosity, I was not too worried. The lieutenant and I went to the warden's office, a huge room with a giant wooden desk on one end, with rows of stuffed leather chairs extending out from both ends of the desk. Gradually, I became worried. Others gathered: Warden Nelson, Associate Warden Administration Park, Associate Warden Custody Wim, the Custody Captain, Custody Lieutenant, several guards, and three members of the Goon Squad, Custody SWAT team. By now I was scared, not knowing what all of them were doing there. Finally, I was told that they had reason to believe I had a copy of The Outlaw in my possession. Panicked, my mind raced as I tried to figure out what to say. Next, I heard someone say that they believed I was the leak to the Berkeley Barb, and then ask if that was true. Again, my mind raced as I started to answer, but stopped, not knowing what to say. Then, the next thing I heard was someone say that they would call and have the Marin County District Attorney come out if I didn't immediately cooperate. Now I knew what to do. I quickly pulled the folded copy of The Outlaw out from inside the top of my pants and handed it to them. If I recall correctly, they didn't ask about the Barb again. However, that was not the end of things. They had me remove my shoes so they could see if I had some sort of hidden compartment in one of the heels. They demanded to see my wallet. They took all the things out of it, including a miniature address book, which they copied along with other personal papers. Next, on their command, I removed articles of clothing from suit jacket to pants, all of which they meticulously searched. Finally, I ended up standing in front of them, stripped to my shorts with arms outstretched. They informed me that I never was to be allowed inside the prison again unless I had the written permission of the warden, two associate wardens and the captain. Then they told me to get dressed and go to my car, accompanied by the three members of the Goon Squad who would search my car, and then leave for the last time, unless we can get you back in here with a number behind your name. Going to my car, I thought of stories I had heard. I feared that the Goon Squad might plant evidence in order to arrest me. I tried to watch all three, attempting to be certain that they did not find something that had not been there before. To say I breathed a gigantic sigh of relief as I drove out through the prison gates for the last time is a gross understatement. My mind raced. I was thankful that I had not been arrested. However, I didn't know if I might have committed some technical crime that would end up allowing CDC or San Quentin authorities to have me arrested. I was certain that I did not want to end up in prison with a number behind my name, as had been noted earlier when I was kicked out. That evening I met with a few people who knew what I had been doing regarding the Outlaw and the Barb. They shared my concern about what my legal status was. I tried, but failed to get a call through to a young attorney they knew for advice. I was frightened, unsure where I legally stood. Later, one individual came into the room and gave me a yellow pen with black lettering that read, "Even paranoids have real enemies." He told me I needed it more than he did. That night turned out to be quite restless for me, with very little sleep. Well, that ends today's chapter, Prisoner Protest the Outlaw, from the book Danger and Trust, San Quentin, the Mexican Mafia, and the Chicano Movement by Ted Davidson. Hopefully you appreciate today's history lesson on the Outlaw San Quentin's Chicano Prisoner Underground newspaper. Please drop a comment. What do you think? How do you feel about the resistance the Chicano prisoners received for trying to organize a united front peacefully? Or why no alleged Mexican mafia experts or informant authors have ever referenced this book or events? Make sure to subscribe, like the channel, let the homies know about the channel, and tune in next time when we read from the chapter, Convict Unity Holiday. Find out what iconic 60s rock band performed a free concert outside San Quentin in support of Convict Unity Holiday.